Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom Feens Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi cover the punk rockinist, hip hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half free. The Freedom Feens Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's freedomfeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Welcome to the Vaporsmith's Freedom Hour with Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean.
Broadcasting from my windowless bunker.
And Neema Vedadi.
Go, go, Freedom Fiends!
Go, go, Freedom Neem.
Go, go, Freedom Dean. What it do?
Not a lot. I'm wondering if the audio is going to be any better here. I've rigged something up. I'm actually going to do a blog post about this. I made this little egg crate foam thing that wraps around the H2 except for in the front, so it protects from room reflection on the side a little bit. So there's going to be less room echo in this one. But there's probably going to be some wind. I can hear it sometimes through the windows right now.
Is that what inspired it, the windy Wyoming?
Nah, it was actually the last couple episodes I did, at least the last couple SEO solo joints with Garrett, I accidentally had the back microphone on the H2 also, so I was getting more room echo than usual. But then I fixed that. And then determined that even with just the front mic on, my usual recording setup, I get more echo in my bedroom than when I was doing this out in the living room, which...
Your bedroom's smaller.
Well, also because I was sitting on a couch, and there's more curtains in that room. There's more bare walls in here. I thought about hanging up some stuff, but I didn't want to, like, turn this into a rubber padded room. Like, I had my room in Agora. When a DJ and I lived in California, I completely made one of the bedrooms into like a recording studio. Like, I nailed up rugs on every wall and like soundproofed the window. It was really kind of creepy, but it was like there was a lot of external noise and I was feeling poked by the world. And here it's like there's no external noise except wind. No one goes down my street. It's not even a through street. There it was like...
Plus, you already have a room like that in your house now. You don't need two of them.
Well, I have the booth closet down in the basement. But, you know, that's not where I record podcasts. It's where I record voiceover.
Right, of course.
Which, if y'all listen to LRN.FM, you'll be noticing there's a... I recorded a commercial this week with DJ doing an ad for a sex toy company. So,
a family-owned sex toy company, no less.
So, you're listening to the Free Talk Live. We'll be playing that the next month or so.
Good deal. I look forward to hearing that. I'm a regular listener of Free Talk Live.
Yeah. I've been watching Reno 911. I love it.
It's a great show. Great show.
It's the only good cop show because it portrays cops as they really are.
Ridiculous.
And, like, not just ridiculous, incompetent, and violent, but... into their monopoly. Like, I'm watching this one now where there's this citizen patrol guy who's played by Pee Wee Herman.
Yeah.
Who's like solving all the crimes that the cops can't solve, and then they're trying to like stop him from solving crimes. They don't want they'd rather the crimes go unsolved than a non-cop solve them.
Oh, it makes them look bad.
Yep.
Can you imagine how upset the cops would be if they started reducing police forces? No. Yeah. The media always gets out there and does stories. Once or twice a year, they do a story about how there needs to be more police, and the city council is talking about adding a new officer position or two just to keep the streets safe. That's what they want it to be. They don't want it to be, well, you know, we don't really need all these police. Let's get rid of some of these positions and get rid of your 20-year, you know, you just work for 20 years and then you're set for life pensions.
You know, I was really inspired by your interview with Larkin Rose, which is up on the podcast now. People can go listen to it. It was great. I loved it. And anything I've said about doubting him before was based on not understanding what he was about. And he even used our words. He said there are no magic words to make the government go away.
Yeah, he sure did. He was well aware of the situation. And like like he said, most of the stuff written about him, you know, on Wiki or wherever, is written by the tax. No, he called him extortionist apologists.
Yeah, yep, I loved it. Yeah. Wiki's actually down right now. A lot of websites are down for 24 hours to protest the coming possibility of SOPA. But we had a discussion of it and decided not to. It's
I think while the other slaves are doing their boycott thing, we're setting up the Underground Railroad.
Yeah, exactly. I like that. You know, the Underground Railroad, there was actually a room that was used for that in the carriage house of the house I grew up in.
Oh, yeah. You were telling me that. Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah.
The old 180-year-old house that my dad still lives in. But, yeah, I mean, it's, we don't see, first of all, everyone that's doing that are people who want to reform the government, and we don't do that.
We don't want to lend legitimacy to the government's threats. They're threatening to shut down the internet. We're saying, try it, bitches.
Yeah. And, you know, I've been training my carrier pigeons. How about you?
Always, yeah. I've even got a few bald eagles for the irony.
Yeah, and, you know, we've been collecting all of those donations to have a carrier pigeon for every one of the fiends, and we will send out little thumb drives to your house weekly once the internet's down. And so that's what you've been sending that $1,000 a month for. We appreciate it.
Please send them back with a tip. Fold up a little – no, don't fold up a dollar bill. Put a little silver dime in the pouch.
There you
send
go.
It back to us.
There you go. Now, we're not soliciting funds to have imaginary pigeons in our backyard.
We're not?
Damn. But I do have a good point, something I want to talk about. PayPal has been freezing people's funds for using a donate button when not being a 501c3. I have a post on michaelwdean.com that I'll link from this episode about workarounds for that.
Right, and that's a really upsetting thing for me to learn about. You know, I don't know, sometimes us libertarians here, I don't know, me personally at least, I can be too optimistic, and I know that the founder of PayPal is a decent little libertarian coming up with ideas for seasteading and stuff like that. So it really irks me when I hear about something like this. Any idea why they're doing this, Michael?
I'm sure it's because of the government. But the thing that really bugs me about it is that there's nothing on the site that says that. Or at least if there is, it's buried somewhere that I couldn't find from 10 or 15 minutes of poking around and reading their whole user's agreement. You know, it should be like when you go to make a button, you know, there's different options. There's a buy button, a subscribe button, a donate button. For the donate button, it should say, if they're going to do this, it should say, to use the donate button, you must be a licensed 501c3 nonprofit organization. Because recently, people have been having their funds frozen for that. Regretsy.com had a toy drive for sick kids. It was legitimate, but they weren't a licensed nonprofit with a permission slip to give money to kids. And Sheriff Mack just had $40,000 seized. It was for his
that's awful.
Sheriff's conference, which, you know, I mean, part of my workaround is, first of all, I would never let anywhere near. First of all, I've never seen that much money in my life. You know, that's a quality problem.
in one place.
Yeah,
right.
Literally from working or donations or anything. Secondly, I never let any amount of money accrue in PayPal over $200. You know, I either spend it on expenses, like I'm coming up here at the end of this month, I'm going to pay our streaming host for a year, because they only have two plans. It's monthly or yearly, and I'd rather do 1 year up front. So they take PayPal, so I'm going to pay that with PayPal. And yeah, like DreamHost takes PayPal, so I pay that with PayPal. Or if there wasn't something I had to pay or could pay up front, there was an expense, I would cash it out, even though you lose a little money cashing it out. You don't lose any money making a payment with it. But I would rather, if I had $40,000 of money sitting in PayPal, I'd cash it out even if it cost me $5,000, you know?
Oh, yeah. I think I'd feel that same way, too. The other thing I'm thinking here, now that you mention it, is this has to be some type of government pressure. And the thing is, it doesn't have to necessarily be a law on the books or something explicitly stated somewhere. I mean, there are regulators that can come and talk to companies and, you know, basically pressure them without the public ever knowing about it. And that's, of course, one of the evil things about the giant cabinet-level regulatory structure, is they can go to a company and say, hey, you guys need to make sure this isn't happening. And then the public never knows about it other than actions like this.
My big problem, I mean, people have to work with the government to run corporate, you know, big businesses in this country, or they'll just get shut down.
Right.
So that's the government's fault. But I really think PayPal is complicit, because all they have to do is add one fucking line of text on their site that says, don't use this button if you're not a licensed 501c3. Use the other button. And that's what my blog post is about, is the other button and how to find it and use it.
Right. Which is, really upsetting why they wouldn't do that, because it seems like it'd be really easy to do. And also, I mean, what's going to happen? I mean, I think we should follow up and find out what happens to this $40,000. Is Sheriff Mack fighting to get it back? Is he going to get it back?
Yeah,
I mean,
he's talking about a lawsuit, and he's got some lawyers who are going to work pro bono on it.
Good, because I know Mac is a fighter, and I think it's a great thing for him to be out in the world speaking. I mean, we interviewed him in our movie, and before that, I mean, the way we actually got him was I was covering the Wyoming Liberty Fest down in Lander, Wyoming, and I went down there with the movie camera too, and I saw Sheriff Mac. He gave a speech, and he had me from hello, basically. He was just up there talking about, I used to be a sheriff, and law enforcement is ridiculous, and they shouldn't write you tickets for speeding, and all this great stuff. And, you know, here's this square guy who used to be a sheriff saying all these things. He's really great at convincing the old square red state people that freedom's the way to go. Yeah. He's still a constitutionalist, but like you said, Michael, he's your favorite constitution humper. One of them, at least.
Yeah, and he'd probably be appalled to be called that. But
yeah, he would.
But, you know, we call everybody who does that. And I think that a lot of constitutionalists, in their heart of hearts, know that these rights don't come from the piece of paper. You know, they're just trying to enforce the law of the land. Some of them do, but I'm convinced Ron Paul knows that it doesn't come from that. And I think Sheriff Mack gets that based on a couple, like, he corrected himself at one point when he's talking, you know. He said something about something being granted and then corrected himself, I think, to, you know, preserved by this document or something.
Yeah, he sure did. I think they understand that. They understand that natural rights exist, at least the good constitution humpers. You know, the evil statists obviously think you only get rights that are granted by the government. I think that the difference there is that people who still stick to the constitution, I don't think they have enough faith in freedom or the market yet. They think there still needs to be some level of monopoly and some level of it being written down somewhere for it to have an effect.
I really liked Larkin's description of his journey, and I like that you asked him, how did you get to where you are? And he's like, well, my whole life, most of my life, I didn't believe this, and I was, you know, believed I should do what I'm told and blah, blah, blah. And he said that he likes rhetorical arguments. I don't know if that's the term, but, you know, he likes debating with people and doing it intelligently and without having a
logical fallacy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, he likes doing it without fallacies. And he would make these arguments for smaller and smaller government and then just realize that every argument for any government just contradicted everything else he said.
Exactly. So it sort of whittled itself down. As he was seeking truth, what he ended up with was liberty.
Well, that's kind of a common thing. You know, there's a term, I think it's even from the Bible, of the path narrows. It's the more you seek any truth, the narrower and narrower the path gets.
Right.
You know, which can be a bummer thing with some things. It's like, you know, if you're seeking purity of the body or something, you know, or health or physical health, you know, you might have to just keep stopping everything that's fun until you're eating nothing but, you know, carrots and beans. You know, people have to give up fat and as you get older, if you want to stay healthy, you have to give up, you know, fat, drinking, smoking, et cetera, et cetera.
I think the thing is you got to eat more fat. I've been following this primal stuff lately and I'm getting more and more convinced as I follow along. I've lost a few pounds myself. I think the problem with the modern American diet is the sugar, not the fat. And the sugar changes the way insulin works in your body and makes it keep all the fat. Where if you get...
I'm probably going to say, stop talking about this and end up doing it like I did with Vaporsmiths. But I won't say stop talking about it. I will say it's interesting. Are you talking about the caveman diet or are you talking about Atkins or something else?
No, it's something different.
Because the caveman diet keeps coming up in liberty discussions. And
right. Well, maybe it's a misnomer then. I rarely hear it called caveman diet anymore, although...
It's called the paleo diet?
Paleo diet or primal. The idea is to eat stuff that's more natural, to not eat stuff that's processed. And that includes grains. So when they consider stuff being processed, they consider it anything agricultural, anything starting since mankind decided to grow a bunch of grass and figure out ways to turn it into
bread. Well,
basically
it's like those things weren't grown because they were optimum foodstuffs. They were grown because
they were easy to grow.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. So the idea is to eat animals, animal fats, and vegetables.
Yeah. So anyway, Sheriff Mack, you know, interesting thing about rights and natural rights I'm pulling us back. I've got
that's
the rope.
Fine. I've got, oh, the, you rope, got the rope. So it's the, it's the hook. It's the gong, like yeah. in the Republican debates with Ron Paul.
Speaking of gong, I was going to say, I really like Paul Bonneau's idea that not many people have, too. And he's basically anarchist the same way we are and started from kind of where we came from. Paul Bonneau's idea is that there's no such thing as rights. I think his idea is basically that there's no rights granted or even natural rights. It's just basically what you can fight for and keep people from taking from you. Right. And being ethical. But
right. And the way I would come at that is, in essence, there's no rights because there's just freedom. I mean, everything that you do, as long as it doesn't violate the non-aggression principle, is right, as you could say. There's nothing wrong with it. So it's not as if there's a list of rights. We still talk about rights. I still use that word sometimes just because that's what people know. People understand it. It's yep. a thing. It's a thing with language.
Yep. I'd love to have Paul Bonneau on and do an interview with him, but he's I've asked him, and he's kind of microphone shy, but definitely not shy in writing. He writes some of those powerful stuff I've read.
We could do a text interview with him, and then one of us could play Paul Bonneau. Yeah.
We could do that. I've met him. I don't know if I could play him. He's a complex character, an interesting cat. But so, Gong Show. Did you hear, I think it was Romney, at the South Carolina Republican debates, one of them was talking about something Ron Paul said. I think it was Rick Perry. I think he's still there. Said, well, I think the sound we were looking for when Ron was talking was the sound of a gong.
Yeah, well, there was, I never watched the other people talking. I usually just watch the Ron Paul highlights. So, but I think I did see the answer Perry was talking about. There was one where Ron Paul just sort of went on and on and on. It was mostly Brett Baer's fault because Brett Baer was trying to put words in his mouth saying that Ron Paul was bowing to international law. And Ron Paul wanted to make it clear that he wasn't. Yeah. It was natural law that he was talking about. And Brett Baer just kept pressing him on it. So Ron Paul just, he had a lot of spunk in this one. So yeah. He was basically not sitting there and taking it from either the moderators or the other folks. And that's, I think, what this stemmed from.
Yeah.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com.
It's getting nasty. The gloves are off. Another thing that was horrible that was said about Ron Paul was Newt Gingrich said, basically compared Ron Paul to insecticide.
Insecticide? Because yeah. The government is parasites?
No. He said...
That's what I would get from that. Ron Paul is insecticide.
Yeah. For the politics, the many ticks of politics, the many bloodsuckers of politics. Yes. No, he said something like, you know, I agree with a lot of what Ron Paul says. He's got some great points that not a lot of people make, and I agree with about 98% of what he says. But, you know, insecticide, I mean, it's 98% inert ingredients, but those other 2% will kill you.
I would love to kill... No, I didn't say that.
Okay, that's getting edited out.
Oh, damn it. You can just bleep it.
Can they kick in your door for a bleep now? I don't know.
I don't know. Let's find out. We'll be the guinea pig.
Yeah. That was Neema Vedadi.
That was me.
Not me.
I did interview Larkin, so I'm a little bit ballsier today than usual, I guess.
I know. It fills you with... Yep. I mean, I'm wondering if interviewing Larkin gets you a knock at the door these days or gets your door kicked in or gets you droned. He's the ballsiest guy we've had on, sure. Well, yeah. I mean, not that Robin isn't ballsy, but Robin's working within the system. Larkin's like, F the system.
Yeah. System? I wouldn't even call it that.
But he's so polite, he probably wouldn't even say the F word, you know?
Yeah, yeah. He's an all-around nice guy.
Yep, I liked him. So the other horrible thing from the South Carolina thing was Ron Paul said of our military policy, something like, you know, why don't we just have a golden rule with other countries of don't do anything to them they wouldn't do to us.
And he got booed. Booed. Can you believe that? Right, right. Whereas the opposite end of the spectrum, to show you what the audience is and how far some people have gone over the edge of insanity, Newt said he wanted to do what Andrew Jackson did to America's enemies. Kill them. And he got like a standing ovation. I don't know if it was a standing ovation, but he got round of applause that was loud as hell. And A, I'm thinking, didn't Andrew Jackson like massacre the Native Americans? And it's just the bloodthirst. I don't understand it, Michael. Why are mainstream Republicans so bloodthirsty?
Why does everyone have a boner for killing everyone else, man? And it's not just killing everyone else. It's like, oh, damn it. I looked up Andrew Jackson. I forgot Wikipedia was blacked out. And and the way they're doing it is like it goes to the site for like a half second to the article you're looking up.
Right, so you're anticipating that, and then it's just a black page that says protest SOPA or something like that.
Yeah, that's not how it's going to work when they do SOPA. It's going to work like if you click on a page, a drone will target your house.
Is that how it's going
to
work?
They'll let you look at the page to keep your mind off the drone so you don't run from the drone.
Oh, I see. I see. You won't even know what hit you. It'll be like Moon. You'll just get vaporized.
Yep.
Well, here's my answer for why people are so bloodthirsty and why people cheer at Newt. If you feel that way, you're a giant pussy. You're really scared.
Go do it yourself, man.
You're really scared of Iran or whoever for some unknown reason. You just put the cover over your head at night and you cower and you're scared that these people who don't even know you exist and don't even give a shit about you are going to come and hurt you. They're the boogeymen and you want mean old Newt Gingrich to protect you. And it's bull.
You know, I know that when people say things like, oh, my stepson's going into the military, and someone else says, oh, tell him thank you for me. You're really disgusted by that. I have something for Neema Vedadi to respect about soldiers. At least they're f***ing going and doing it themselves and not sending someone else. In some twisted way, can't you respect that more than you can respect old, sexless men who want to send young men to die for them, who've never done it themselves?
Yes. I don't know if I'd say I respect them more, but I would say in that sense, they upset me less. I mean, yeah, I think a chicken hawk is worse on that level of intellectual consistency, because somebody like Newt Gingrich is going to send your kid to die for him.
Yeah.
At least there was a voluntary decision made there by the soldiers, but at the same time, it's involuntary that they're taking money, they're stealing my money to do it. So at the same time, I'm more upset with them.
You know, there was something I really liked in Boston's Gun Bible. It was like an open letter to the gun grabbers, and it was something like, and it was said a lot more eloquently than I can paraphrase it, but it was something like, if you want to vote to get guns taken away from people, if you support politicians, or if you are a politician, if you want guns taken away from citizens, someone's going to have to go around and do the taking away. And you should know that if they come to my house to take my guns, I'm going to kill them. They'll kill me, but I'm going to kill them first. So if you believe that strongly, that guns should be taken away from people, don't send someone else's son or daughter to go door to door and do it. Do it yourself.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. And I really feel that way. I have a Facebook friend who was – I rarely ever hear from her. She never looks at my page. But I posted a thing about how ridiculous John Huntsman is because he wanted to put ground troops in Iran. And she, I guess, is in the Army Special Forces. And so she felt the need to talk about how this was necessary. And we weren't going to kill anybody. We're just going to put ground troops in Iran. Yeah, how's that going to work out? Really? Really? We're going to invade another country and there's going to be no deaths. How blind are you, A? And B, she made herself sound like she was this very moral, upright person who's willing to help the needy and go and take care of this job for us because she's so brave. And I told her, basically, you know, if you want to go fight the bad guys, go do it by yourself. And fine, if you are actually fighting bad guys, bully for you. But if you're stealing my money, then I will not support you. And if you throw the first punch, if you're out there just randomly aggressing against people or killing people because some grandma back in Florida is scared of them, then I'm not on your side. And I won't root for you. In fact, I'll root against you because you're the aggressor.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
And now, some corporate whoring for one of our favorite products.
Hi, I'm Neema Vedadi from the Freedom Fiends podcast, and I'm excited about Vaporsmith's electronic cigarettes. I dig the taste, and I dig the freedom to vape anywhere the nanny staters would wet their pants if I smoked.
Howdy, I'm Michael Dean of the Freedom Fiends, and I love Vaporsmith's. I smoked 3 packs of tobacco cigarettes a day for decades, but now I'm only using Vaporsmith's. I love the flavors, I don't smell like smoke, and I save money, so I have more to spend on ammo and treats for my kiddies.
Vaporsmith's e-cigs revolutionize nicotine ingestion by bringing it into the 21st century. With Vaporsmith's, you'll enjoy all the invigorating nicotine with none of the nasty smoke. Vaporsmith's are clean, efficient, and tasty. Available in 4 strengths and 10 delicious flavors. Reds, classics, Turkish, menthol, strawberry, cherry, vanilla, coffee, minty mint, and cloves. Go to Vaporsmiths.com. Use coupon code FREEDOMFIEND to get 25% off your order. This is a limited time offer. Vaporsmiths.com is run by a liberty-loving entrepreneur, not some subsidized tax-eater conglomerate. Vaporsmiths at Vaporsmiths.com. Vaporsmiths. I'm enjoying one right now.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Freedom Fiends, anti-war, pro-gun. New show on the Micro Effect Radio Network, Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi's fun and feisty weekly chat about constitutional, libertarian, minarchist, and anarchist issues, abuse of authority by police, the war on drugs, the war on guns, self-defense, states' rights, natural rights, Austrian economics, DIY art, low-budget filmmaking, digital recording, activism, rock and roll, and more. Freedom Fiends. Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Learn more about The Micro Effect at themicroeffect.com.
You know, the thing they teach you in all the history books about the American Revolution is that the British fired the first shot, you know, and that our side had orders not to fire until fired upon. I read a book, I can't remember what it was called, but it was some history of Paul Revere's life, written by patriots. It's something that they recommend at Appleseed, and it actually has a theory in there and has some information that seems to back it up, that the first shot was probably fired by someone on the American side. Which completely turns everything about history you're taught in school upside down.
It does, but at the same time, you know, I think
they were pushed so far already that it was self-defense or
Yeah. I think I could make that argument because, you know, you can't tell me that some American colonists didn't get attacked by any of the colonial police or whoever they had there as the enforcers of the empire. That had to have happened at some point. Plus, they were being stolen from. I mean, they were being taxed, and that was what the whole thing was about.
You know, the interesting thing is, too, that revolution was fought over injustices that, if you put them in numeric ways, are tiny compared to day-to-day life in America now.
I mean, yeah.
You know, the amount of tax that was levied on them that pushed them to revolution was like 1% basically income tax, you know, or sales tax on things they produced.
Yeah, it was minute, but people were really upset about it then because it was more apparent. You know, you didn't have things like withholding where you don't really notice that they're stealing your money.
Well,
or things like sales tax where, you know, everything's electronic and you just don't notice. You just get rung up at the cash register. You pay whatever they ask.
Well, they've really mastered the slow, steady, invisible tyranny. But Larkin had a really good point, is that they're blowing it. Because they are ramping it up. You know, the last two presidents have ramped it up so much.
Bush
and Obama.
They started out slow, but now they're getting impatient and they're ready to
come. The frogs are going, I'm boiling. Oh my God, it's getting hot in here. Yeah. I don't want to just keep paraphrasing that interview. People should go listen to it if they didn't.
Go listen to the interview, yeah.
It's the episode right before this one in the feed.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was good. Yeah, I mean, you know, in 1775, with the first shot of the revolution, there was no... Well, there was gun control, actually. I was going to say there was no gun control, but there actually was. That the revolution was basically about a tiny tax and threatening to take away not the guns people had in their home, but the citizen militia. You know, take away the armory where they kept the guns and the... basically right. Where they kept the gunpowder.
Right, right. Whereas, you know, these days we're smart enough to keep the gunpowder in our house and not tell anybody. Well, oops, I guess I screwed that one up.
People kept gunpowder in their house, but it was like nobody then and most people now don't have enough in their home to fight a war. And that's what the citizen militia and the, you know, the powder houses that were being seized by the Brits were for.
Speaking of Second Amendment and things like that, another Ron Paul debate thing I thought was interesting was Rick Santorum tried to attack Ron Paul on the Second Amendment. Well, I guess it was in defense for Ron Paul attacking him on the Second Amendment. But Santorum's argument was that he got together with gun manufacturers and made this bill at the national level to prevent lawsuits from happening against gun manufacturers. I guess lawyers were starting to sue gun manufacturers for guns shooting people.
Santorum did?
Santorum said he helped with that bill on the national level, which it does sound like a good thing. Why do you think it's not? Do you think it's not?
You know, the minarchist in me likes things like that, but I haven't read the whole bill. You know, I'm sure there's some concession given in it, too. There is in every bill.
I'm sure there is, too.
Well, what was his beef with Ron Paul?
Ron Paul didn't vote for it.
Did he vote against it or abstain or what?
Ron Paul voted against it. Ron Paul's retort was that tort law shouldn't be decided on a federal level, but on a state level, which Rick Santorum countered with, well, then people would just go to the liberal states to do these lawsuits, which was an interesting point, I thought. Rick Santorum obviously tried to escalate it and say that Ron Paul wanted to obliterate the Second Amendment by not voting for this, which is obviously ridiculous to anybody who doesn't have their head up their ass.
I'm friends with one of the guys that works on Ron Paul's campaign, and he's a constantly armed guy. I can't imagine he's not packing when he's standing. You know, I saw him on national television, my friend the other day, standing behind Ron Paul. I can't imagine he's not armed. And Ron Paul, although all politicians are protected by armed guards, but, you know, Ron Paul has spoken at events in New Hampshire where people are openly carrying and didn't care, and I don't see Santorum or any of those other people not throwing a fuss about that. Oh, yeah. And, you know...
Well, Ron Paul's parry, pardon the pun, was to was to say that, hey, I voted against. I made bills to repeal all the gun bans. We shouldn't have any kind of gun that's banned, basically, was Ron Paul's...
Santorum using that argument against Ron Paul for not voting for that, first of all, it's false saying he's against the Second Amendment. Second of all, it's like an eighth grader challenging a calculus professor on his math. It can't be done. It's basically working within that system. Ron Paul is the purest constitutionalist American history has ever had in Congress that I know of, at least in my lifetime and probably in our history, to the point where he will do things that seem counterintuitive because he's the only one playing by the rules, absolutely playing by the rules. Like he, for instance, was very against invading Iraq, but he put forth a procedure in Congress of
to declare war. So he said, if we want to do this, let's declare the war.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he just knows the rules too well. And all these people are like, well, why didn't you bend the rules to do this good thing?
And he's like, because they're rules, which, again, you know, we're not constitutionalists, but at least Ron Paul has that sense of, hey, if there is a constitution and I swore to uphold it, I'm going to keep my word, which I think is the respectable thing, that he's not a liar.
Larkin is the second libertarian media person I've heard who has put forth the – him and Bad Quaker both had two of the same arguments. I think they came up with it independently. Both said two things I haven't heard many people or anybody say. One was, I hope Ron Paul doesn't win because it will strengthen the government. Mm-hmm. You know, if he streamlines the government, it'll strengthen it, basically. And the other was, I hope he doesn't win because I think he's a cool guy and they will kill him if he becomes president.
Yes. They both said that. Although I think there's a distinction on Larkin's comments about Ron Paul and the government and bad Quakers. It seems to me bad Quakers' argument was more, Ron Paul will make the government more efficient and then it can do evil things more efficiently. I tend to disagree with that because I think Ron Paul is going to just get rid of some of the horrible things in the government, not necessarily make it more efficient.
Well, Larkin said the same thing in a different way.
Well, no, I think Larkin's, and here's why I want to draw the distinction. I think Larkin was saying that Ron Paul would pull back the tyranny. Like he was mentioning tyrants, successful tyrants can do that. They do it slow enough to where people don't notice. I think,
which would strengthen the government. He was saying the same thing.
I don't think
thing,
it would, no, because I think the difference
government
is.
Government versus tyrants?
He's not saying it will strengthen the government. I think he's saying it will strengthen the illusion in people's minds that the government is acceptable. There will be less people calling for the abolishment of the government because they'll see Ron Paul and they'll say, oh, things have gotten better. You know, we have cut $1 trillion. We have cut these things. Maybe this government thing can work if we just keep cutting it.
I still think that's the same thing. I think we're arguing over semantics. They're both saying Ron Paul would make the government more efficient and people would like it and believe in it.
Maybe. But I think Larkin's was more about, because Larkin's whole thing is that, and I guess Bad Quaker's thing too, is that government is an illusion. And I think what Larkin was saying was that Ron Paul making the government
legitimate,
less, it would make it more legitimate in people's minds.
I still think the same thing. And you talked to Larkin, but I talked to Larkin in my dream last night, and he and I were talking with Hubert Selby, who's dead, who's talking to me in my dream. So
okay, so you can have that then, Michael, since you had the dream.
I listened to that interview and then I slept for like 3 hours and then got up at 3 a.m. and was up all night waiting with bated breath to do this because I love podcasting so much. But I had a dream. It was really strange. I dreamt that I was like teleconferencing, like three-way or like five-way Skype conferencing, if that's possible, with Larkin, Hubert Selby, who's dead. You know, I did that movie on him and did the last interview with him before he died. And like two people I couldn't see who were movie, like a producer and a director. And it was, we were all working on a movie that Hubert Selby had written. It wasn't based on a novel. It's like he'd written another script from scratch that was, it was kind of like Last Exit to Brooklyn 2. Like it took place in Brooklyn in the same neighborhood in the same, during the Korean War, right after it. And Larkin and I were like consultants of some sort on it. And we were teleconferencing. Okay. And the only line I remember was not very significant. It was like the director telling Selby, well, if the army base has that radar disc, won't we have to explain to people what radar is? And Selby was like, I think people know what radar is. I think we can just show the disc and people will know what it is.
Yeah, I think Selby was probably right on that. Your imaginary Selby.
That's kind of based on some of my inside knowledge of the stupidity that he dealt with, because in researching that movie, I did get to see photocopies of a stack of about 40 letters written between him and his editor, Gil Sorrentino, his editor at Grove Press, his editor on his first 3 or 4 books. It's like stuff nobody's seen outside of his family and Gil and Gil's family. And Gil is in the movie, and then he died before the movie was finished of cancer. And these letters were outrageous. I mean, it was like, you know, it was his best friend from Brooklyn, and then Selby moved out to L.A. and was in Hollywood and making it in Hollywood in his own twisted, painful way. Hollywood just isn't kind to anybody. And in it, there were also some pages from his book, The Demon, which was published by Playboy Press. Mm-hmm. You know, it was his first one, not on Grove, and he was complaining to Gil about, you know, I wish you were my editor on this. This kid's an idiot. This 25-year-old that's editing my work is an idiot. And it was like, at that point, I mean, Selby'd had a best-selling novel. He'd had a movie made. He was taught in colleges, but he used like really weird typography, like slashes instead of asterisks, and like like shouting all caps, things like that. And
but he did it on purpose because that's the
way
he wanted
it to be read.
Yeah,
and he did it consistently and on purpose, and it was like part of the musicality of how he wrote. And this editor at his new press was like telling him like English 101, like, no, this isn't how you write a sentence.
Yeah. And he's like, no, that's how I write
a sentence. And literally like at this point, there was a college class somewhere called From Selby to Solzhenitsyn. I mean, he was taught in colleges as a paragon of alternative literature, and some punk fresh out of journalism school was saying, no, that's, you need to put quote marks here.
Yeah, yeah, ridiculous. And school does teach you that. University teaches
you. It's not odd that I would have a dream where Selby's going to a producer. No, I think people know what a radar, you know, what a radar thing is.
Right, right. Fair enough.
Yeah, so the L.A. City Council has passed a law that porno movies produced in L.A., the men have to be wearing condoms.
Yes. So literally, the city of L.A. is telling you how to fuck.
Yeah, here was my thought. You know, I don't know where it is or who it is, but there's, I know that there's one couple, they're married and they're monogamous and they're porn stars and they're in a bunch of movies. And they'll be in scenes where there's other people in the scenes, but they're not having sex with the other people. And that's what they do. They're the couple that is always working together. They would be required under this to wear condoms. Now, it's like, I mean, I could picture, like, are they going to go to the city council hat in hand and plead for a variance?
I bet you they will, which will be ridiculous because nobody should tell you how you f***.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast. Freedom Fiends is now available for 24/7 streaming to your iPhone, Android phone, or other chromed robot turd. Click on the streaming audio link on freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
You know, speaking of variances and fucking variances, there's a case in the Supreme Court right now. It's a couple in Idaho bought like their dream 20 acres or whatever and build a house on it. And it was in this really dry part of Idaho. And the EPA came in and determined it was a wetland and said that they had to remove the house they built and revert it to its original state or face, you know, $20,000 a day fine. And it made it to the Supreme Court. And I don't even know if it's decided yet, but one of Kagan's dissents was that, well, why didn't they just go get a wetlands variance? It's not a fucking wetland. It's like almost desert.
Right, right.
And she's like, oh, but the throw chance. the Bill of Rights out the window. Yeah. What, to be secure and you're safe in your home and not have your land taken by the government. You know, why didn't you just go get a piece of paper that admits you agree that they're right, even though they're wrong, and it's not a wetland? And you're, why didn't you get the piece of paper that says it's a wetland, but I want to treat it differently?
Right, right. Basically, your crime becomes not filling out the proper paperwork, which you didn't know how to fill out, and of course, you shouldn't have to fill out because it's your fucking property.
You know, the EPA is the enemy in the Simpsons movie, and they're totally portrayed as jackbooted thugs.
Yeah, they are, which is really good. The Simpsons does do a good job of poking fun at the government.
Yeah, and it's, but it's weird, though, because Hollywood is usually really, really, really pro EPA type, you know, the government must use its guns to protect the itchy algae. And the Simpsons, the Simpsons movie isn't the only one. There's an episode of the Simpsons where the EPA is stomping all over them. It's where the creature called the Scream-a-Pillar decides to take up habitat in Homer, in the Simpsons' backyard. You know, the creature that's sexually, the EPA guy like comes in a helicopter and jumps down with his jackboots literally in their backyard and hands them a pamphlet and says that they can't kill it and it's now a nature preserve. And the he hands them the Scream-a-Pillar pamphlet. It's got a picture of like a giant Scream-a-Pillar like terrorizing a city, but they're really only about 4 inches tall. And Lisa's reading it and she's like, it's sexually attracted to fire and without constant reassurance it will die. Are you sure nature doesn't want this to go extinct?
Exactly, exactly. You and DJ love to quote that without constant reassurance because your cats are like that.
Because our cat, Peanut, without constant reassurance, he will die.
Yeah, yeah. Well, see, good humorists are great at pointing out the ridiculousnesses of authority. And I think that that's why Simpsons does it, is because the more ridiculous, the more funny. So they get rid of their any bias they have towards things like the EPA, which I don't know if they even have, because I don't really consider the Simpsons Hollywood. I think they're more tied to what will play in Peoria and what the average person would
Well, like. It's written and produced by Harvard graduates who came out of the... Harvard has a literary magazine, their English department, called The Lampoon, which the magazine National Lampoon came out of. And all the movies came out of that world.
Well, maybe they're smart enough to know what the average person will find funny then, because The Simpsons is really good at that. So maybe they don't believe it themselves, but they know it'll get a laugh from people like you and
Speaking of good humor, I just discovered something this week. Let me know if you know the reference, and I'll just preface with saying, I've had a good breakfast, and I'm ready to take over the world.
Ah, Pinky and the Brain.
Yeah, I didn't know what it was, man. Garrett said something to me about it, and And I was like, what? And I said it to DJ, and she's like, oh, Pinky in the Brain. You know, she had kids. I didn't live with my daughter when she was that age, and DJ raised kids in the early 90s, so, and Garrett was a kid in the early 90s, so they both knew Pinky in the Brain, and I went and looked it up, and I've ordered, like, all the DVDs on Netflix, because I f***ing love it. There's actually one that's based on Fantasia, you know, the movie Fantasia, the classical music, and the, but it's where, like, Pinky and the Brain build a bunch of tiny robots and try to take over the White House and hold the president hostage and get him to sign the country over to Pinky and the Brain. And I'm like, that would be terrorism now. You couldn't have a children's cartoon that had the president being threatened to give over the country to Americans.
Right, right. Well, they're portrayed as, I mean, the Brain is a bad guy, obviously. We don't want him to actually succeed at taking over the world, do we?
I didn't think he was a bad guy. I liked him. But then again, you know, it's like, you know, he's kind of a bad guy in the same way that, like, Stewie Griffin
see,
is
that's
a bad
why
guy.
It's okay, because he obviously will never succeed at taking over the world. He's a f***ing mouse.
Yeah.
So they can get away with that.
But I actually like, kind of saw the Brain as myself, whereas I don't see Stewie as myself.
Ah, so you want to take over the world, Michael? So does that make me Pinky?
No.
Narf.
Narf. Does that make me Pinky? I didn't even think of that.
I'm offended.
No.
No, I'm not.
So have you heard the Disindoctrination podcast yet?
No, I want to. That's Garrett's new podcast, right, that you've helped him build?
Garrett and Kevin. It's
Yeah, great. No, I got the link there. It's on my to-do queue, so I will be adding that to my regular subscription.
I've been helping him a lot, helping him with audio tips and helping him set up a podcast and do SEO, and we've been recording the SEO stuff for the SEO episodes of this podcast, which somebody said sound like a recording of a tech support call, which it basically is, but better recorded, right. And I edit out the long pauses while he's doing stuff.
Right, right.
I've added a new feature to our website, too. Also, two new features, and explain how to do them in the SEO cast. We now have categories. So at the bottom of every post, there's a category, one of four categories listed. They are Freedom Fiends, which is the weekly Neema and Michael,
right,
heavily produced, wonderfully edited, well-researched episodes like the one you're listening to now. There's one that's SEO, which is my SEO search engine optimization web design course. There's one that's interviews, which is so far two interviews by you, but may include interviews that I do later. And user's manual, which is my user's manual for the human experience. So we don't have separate RSS feeds with them, which is how most people would probably do it. And I think we're taking a chance with dumping them all on the same RSS feed. And I would love to hear feedback of if anyone's bugged by this, or anyone who loves it or has any opinion about having them all going into the same feed.
Well, when we were discussing it, I mean, my point was, it's so easy to not listen to a podcast that you get in your feed. I mean, yeah, it downloads, big deal. If you don't want to listen to it, you don't listen to it. You just delete it. So I don't think it's any extra work or a minute amount of extra work for the listener who might not want to listen to the user's manual.
It might be problematic some places where there's not great internet access, like where they do have DSL, but it's limited. Like, I think in Canada right now, there's a law, or it's just the way everyone does it, to where I think it is a result of regulation, to where they charge you for the amount of internet you use.
Ugh.
Which basically, everyone thinks that net neutrality is a great idea, but if net neutrality passes, that will be one of the many bad side effects of it.
Oh, yeah. I can imagine the government would love something like that. Can you imagine if people had to – people would restrict their internet viewing? That would be a perfect gatekeeper for the government. I'm surprised they're not pushing that more instead of taking the SOPA angle, because it would be more under the radar for people, and I think that they could pass it without people really paying much attention to it. Of course, after it was passed, people would be pissed.
Well, they could pass it with people's support, because a lot of young people – who are like, oh, everything should be free, support the idea of net neutrality, because one of the things it would do is force companies not to favor one type of traffic over another. Like, for instance, well, people think it would make it so they couldn't outlaw BitTorrent, but it would, because SOPA type stuff would be included in it. But, you know, like, for instance, a company owned by Warner Brothers under net neutrality couldn't charge more for non-Warner Brothers streaming media access, whereas now they theoretically could, but they kind of don't, just because there's competition, you know? And really, there should be more competition and less regulation, to where if you don't like someone's plan, there's another one. I mean, really, it's like, with less competition, I mean, there'd be another PayPal that would be, there are other PayPal type things, but they're not as ubiquitous, to where if there was less competition, this thing that I don't like about PayPal, I could just go somewhere else.
Yeah. Well, the thing about the government and the internet is, when we were having this conversation just now, I'm thinking the founders should have maybe, if they could have anticipated it, or maybe there needs to be some kind of constitutional amendment to say Congress shall make no law abridging the internet. But it's there already in the First Amendment, and I'm not a constitution humper.
I really believe it is. I really believe that any attempt to regulate the internet is regulating free speech.
Oh, completely. Completely. And so I think any law, anything at all that even mentions internet in it should not be in the books.
Yeah, I mean, in a lot of countries, you need a license to be a blogger.
Ugh.
And in other countries, there are not licenses for bloggers, but they will shoot you or disappear you.
Right,
you know,
right.
China comes to mind. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of countries, the internet, if you're, you know, right now, India is actually suing, like, YouTube, I think, and who really? It's in our notes somewhere. India is suing, like, two make-your-own-media kind of companies for letting people criticize their leaders.
Really? Yeah. Oh, man. That's tyrannical to the bone.
Tyranny in your neck of the woods got you yowling? Tell the Freedom Fiends about it at talkback@freedomfiends.com.
Yeah, it's right here. Facebook, Google, and others face charges in India. You know, basically for, like, letting people post a page that makes fun of their leaders.
I think we mentioned that in another cast, and I think the bureaucrats were saying, we're not trying to stop freedom of the press. We just think it's important that those who are criticizing our leaders face some kind of consequence. Talking out both sides of their mouth.
Yeah, that's the kind of speech that can almost, people get away with that in D.C. now, too.
Well, I mean, Newt Gingrich, that's his signature move, is he'll throw a bone and say something like, yes, you know, constitutional freedoms are important and we should be free from unwarranted search and seizure. But when it comes to terrorists, we need to have a strong government and strong police forces to go and throw them in jail, basically. He sets it up like he's a believer in the principle. And then he says, but in this case, we don't have to believe that principle.
Yeah. And Nancy Pelosi saying, you know, you can see what's in the bill when it's done, when it's signed.
Right, right. And laughing when somebody asked her about the constitutionality of Obamacare. Yeah. Where do you get the power to do that? Just, ha, 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 I don't give
a shit. And Clinton saying, you know, we need a gatekeeper for the internet. What exactly did she say and when was that? I'm going to look that one up.
Just Google it. I don't remember when it was. And I don't know if it was something she was necessarily pushing for, like a well-thought-out, well-researched plan. I think it was just her commenting on what needs to be done, and I think gatekeeper was one of the things she mentioned. There needs to be some type of control, I think, was her angle. And so she used the word gatekeeper, which is also a word we learned in journalism school, but not as a bad thing. We learned that
you were the gatekeepers.
Right. The phrase was, we don't tell the public what to think, but we tell them what to think about.
Yeah. Yeah. So, right.
Sort of Fox's, we report, you decide, but inherently Fox decides what to report, so they're telling you what you can discuss.
I've actually figured out one thing about Fox. I think one of the reasons they're so anti-Ron Paul is because all of these other candidates would back some kind of SOPA type thing, and Fox is really, really litigious about people using their stuff on the internet.
But you see a lot of stuff, though, on YouTube. I mean, you have things like Mox News and stuff like that where, I mean, you see all the debate stuff. You see, of course, anything where anything's been in the media and they mention Ron Paul, somebody posts it on YouTube, and it usually stays there.
Yeah, maybe they got sick of fighting it under the current laws, and they want stronger laws.
They want stronger laws. Yeah. Yeah. They want more government
jackboots. They want to be able to drone you if you post anything from Fox on YouTube, maybe.
Man, Bill O'Reilly would have, like, the most drone kills in the world if that were possible.
Oh, I know.
Allegedly.
So, yeah, the thing I was going to say about Garrett and Kevin's podcast, Disindoctrinate. DJ named that, by the way. They were going to call it something, I forget what it was, but it sounded really socialist.
It was like Liberty for third graders or something?
No, that was one of the intermediaries of how we got to, no, especially Liberty for eighth graders. You know, something like, okay. I was thinking something like Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure in Liberty. I don't know, something like that.
Right.
They're smarter than that, but they're kind of like, dude, check out Liberty. It's great, which I really dig. It's like, it's rare these days for me to hear someone as excited about Liberty as they are. And mm-hmm. as excited about like having a voice finally of having a podcast. You know, I mean, they're really, the, you know, the thing I said in one of the episodes of it was it kind of reminded me of Watson, come here, I need you, which is, you know, the first thing that was transmitted over a telephone ever.
Okay.
Of just wow, like it's almost like
this new thing.
They're so excited about having a podcast in their first episode that it's like it sounds like they just invented the internet. Not that, not like they think they did, but just they, it sounds like they feel like they just invented podcasting or something. They're that excited about it, which is really refreshing to me.
Yeah, it is. And I think a lot of times we as libertarians or anarchists or anybody who hates the state, which is good. I think you should hate the state. But I think the flip side of that is you should love liberty. And I think too often we forget about that and we just talk about the tyranny and the things we hate. But sometimes it's important to talk about why we love liberty, why freedom is great and how excited we are about it. And so I think that if that's what they're doing, then more power to them. I'm gonna start listening.
I'm really excited about helping them and putting it up as podcasts to help other people. It's kind of a thing of, again, I go back to like a lot of what I learned about life, I learned from AA. Like in AA, the way you stay sober once you've been sober a while is you get a sponsee and you are that person's sponsor. You know, it's kind of like a little brother that you're helping keep sober. I mean, they can even be older than you. Your sponsee can be older than you, but it's someone that you've been sober longer than they have, and you know more about staying sober and living life sober without going crazy than they do, and you help them with it. And it's kind of like, I'm kind of Garrett's podcasting sponsor. You know, he's got the liberty thing down. He understands that.
But
he didn't know how to do a good recording or make a podcast or SEOize it. And doing that on an ongoing basis, I mean, at first I was thinking like, I'll just do this two or three episodes of it with him and then go back to doing it with me. But it's like, I could see doing more and more of them. You know, first of all, because I want to teach everybody in Liberty how to make their podcast better, how to make their websites better, how to get them more popular. I want to give back. I want to...
We're on the same team.
Yeah, basically. We really are on the same team. I don't see it as competition, although we are becoming one of the most popular podcasts out there. But, you know, that's just proof of concept to me. And other people can do what I do. And if you go listen to all those episodes and follow all the links on them and read the articles that I've linked carefully, some of the stuff I wrote, some stuff other people wrote, you will be able to have a podcast that sounds as good as ours and gets as popular, probably.
Yeah, yeah. Excellent.
Basically, what I want to happen is to have Liberty Media, true Liberty Media, not this, you know, Republican, libertarian, work within the system crap. True Liberty Media, I really want to have it become a major force, you know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, my dream is we need something like Fox News, but for liberty. We need something that's 24 hours a day, comments from the right direction, you know, the direction of freedom instead of the direction of statism. And that's really hard to do because it requires a lot of funding, but I think there's got to be a way we can do it.
If there are any libertarian billionaires out there who want to fund this to start, Neema and I would be the perfect people to start it. With the experience you and I have in broadcasting and media production and music and dissemination and writing books and running businesses, we would be the perfect people to do it. So I'm just going to put that out there. If there are any libertarian billionaires listening, anarcho-capitalist billionaires listening, you know, just PayPal us. No, don't PayPal us. You know, call us up. We'll give you your address. You can have your men come by with the pallet of gold and drop it on the porch.
Pallet of gold, exactly. Yeah. Just helicopter it on over. Yeah, that's what we need.
Yeah, we'll give you our GPS coordinates and you can just drone it into our backyard.
But could you imagine that? Could you imagine some channel like that having the status to where we could interview or we could go to Washington, we could send a correspondent to where the press meeting.
Oh yeah, we'd hire all our friends.
Right, and they could go and they'd actually ask good questions when the president is giving a press conference. You know, they'd be like, "Why do you think you can kill all these people and get away with it?" And the president would have to say something like, because I have a monopoly of force and guards.
I mean, I think that in some ways, Obama did talk about having the most transparent administration. In a lot of ways, that it's turned out to be a joke. But in some ways, you know, occasionally, it's almost like the robot is malfunctioning. Like, there have been him and a few other people in his administration have said things that are just really, like, he has said, yeah, well, government is something that has a monopoly on violence. Like, that's something anarchists usually say to criticize government, and government usually never ever admits.
Well, there was an interesting discussion on Free Talk Live. A caller called in, and I guess he used to be on the left. And he was saying, you know, back in my day when I was learning about this and when I was in a government college, they told us about this, but the spin on was it was a good thing. It was there should only be one entity allowed to commit violence, because otherwise it seems like
everyone does it.
Yeah, it seems like what libertarians are saying is they want more people out there committing violence, is I think the way somebody who's still stuck in their status mindset sees it.
Yeah, which is not how it is.
Right. What I think the idea is that there shouldn't be any initiation of force initially, and also there should never be one group that reserves the right to do it in any case.
Well, I really liked Larkin's response, you know, when he was talking about the stupidity of prisons and how they don't solve anything. You know, he did say most of the people that are in them shouldn't be in them, and there are some people who should never be allowed to play in society again because they're so violent. And if they came into my neighborhood, I'd be willing to use force. And that's kind of, I think, how it would work, which sounds really vigilante. But I don't know. It just sounded more ethical to me than we should have this jobs program for these goons running around busting people and throwing them in cages and beating them up for having plants.
Right, right.
You know, Obama admitting in that clip that governments, he was talking about using contractors instead of soldiers for military purposes, and he was saying mm-hmm. he didn't really like the idea of doing it much because
right. really, it took away from the monopoly.
Right. Mm-hmm. And him admitting that, I mean, to me, it just seemed like, you know, the machine malfunctioning to where there's fluid leaking out of its ear or something, like oil leaking right. out of its ear. You know,
right. you've got a coolant leak in Sector 4.
Yeah, I mean, he might as well have, in Westworld, the people behind the scenes are going, oh, yeah. Have you seen Westworld, by the way?
No.
Great anti-utopian movie from the 70s. It's parodied a lot, especially in The Simpsons. There's this world where you go for recreation. It's like the Old West, but the cowboys are all robots, and you can shoot them and kill them, and you can make love to the women. So, and then the robots turn malfunction and turn on the people, and it happens slowly. But the robots can't shoot the people. The robots can tell with infrared vision. They can tell if people are warm or if they are cold robots, and they don't shoot back, and you get to shoot them and kill them.
Ah.
And there's a West world and a Roman world and some other world. And, you know, they basically all look like Epcot Center, which is that like 50s, 60s, 70s horrible vision of the future.
Why do you think it was horrible? I don't know much about Epcot.
You should read about Epcot. Well, for one thing, Epcot makes laws. Epcot basically, it's a corporation that has like legal jurisdiction in the county it's in and makes laws in the county it's in.
Hmm.
That's one of the scary things about it. Also, in that movie, what's the other anti-utopian? Logan's Run that I saw last week.
Yeah.
Their city of the future looks like exactly almost like Epcot.
So a lot of people have been creeped out by Epcot. It's not just...
Yeah, and I actually had notes to talk about Epcot. Where was I going with this? Oh, I was saying that like Obama... Damn it, Wikipedia's blacked out. We can't do our podcast.
Arrgh.
I mean, they'd love that. They're like, well, that's the point we're trying to make. If you don't contact your senators and tell them. But
right, because Google has that too. On Google, they've got a little black mark over Google, a little piece of black tape. And if you click on it, it tells you to call your senator.
Epcot, what it stands for is kind of scary. It stands for Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow. You know, it's basically Walt Disney's view of how... Mm-hmm. Corporations should force governments to make cities or just bypass the cities and have the governments. But it's not libpair, man. It's like that guy, you know, wanted to control people.
Right, right. It's planned.
Yeah, it's planned. And Epcot forces citizens who are not involved in Epcot who live in that county, like their building codes and their uh-huh. taxes and their city structure, etc.
So they act like a government.
So the thing that was surprising to me about Obama leaking oil out of his ears and admitting that government is, in its definition, a monopoly of violence. I mean, the next sentence out of his mouth could have been, he could have just said, well, you know, war is bullshit and patriotism is bullshit, but it's an important part of our jobs program. Without
right,
it, those soldiers
right.
and cops wouldn't have...
Right. The Keynesian and Paul Krugman idea of, you know, if we just had a fake alien invasion and we had to do war preparations, then that would get the economy rolling
yeah.
again. Or if we just had World War III, that would get the economy rolling again, which is utterly ridiculous. This was also brought up in the most recent South Carolina Republican debates. One of the moderators asked Ron Paul, you know, what about all those jobs in South Carolina? As if that's the important part. As if it's okay to pay people... It's okay to kill people as long as somebody's getting paid for it.
Well, that's part of what keeps the status quo is the patriot. I mean, you will get booed at best and beat up behind a bar at worst if you criticize our war effort. It's always been like that in every country.
That's nothing
it's
new.
Not
that's
our
nothing
thing. New. It's every country, you know. I mean, right. The Alien and Sedition Acts, you know, people were thrown out of America for protesting the war back in the day.
Or thrown in jail and spent many years in there, even after the war was over.
Yeah.
So this kind of stuff is nothing new, but it is something that we need to make extinct.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let us know if the website is loading faster for y'all, because I did a little bit of voodoo behind the scenes with the caching settings and plugins and stuff, and it should be loading faster.
Yeah.
You won't notice it, Neema, because it doesn't work if you're a logged-in user, and you and I are the only users that could log in. So,
Okay. I don't think I'm logged in on my wife's computer, so I'll check it out from her computer.
Okay. And I have some news you can use. Garrett said if you want to – he downloaded the Dolphin HD internet browser, and it works great on his Android, and there's an Alexa plugin for it.
Oh, good, good, good. What is the default browser on Android phones? Do you know?
I have no idea, but he said that the Dolphin HD browser works better than the default. It's faster, and it allows for tabbed browsing, which the default one doesn't.
I see.
You know, so you can have several pages open.
Okay, okay. Excellent. That is good news you can use.
So did you hear about the GOP trying to bribe Ron Paul into not running third party?
No, but I mean, they have been noticing this. There was a few pundits I heard, and they were discussing.
Pundit. You said pundit.
Yeah, that's what I said, right? Pundit?
Pundit.
That's what I said.
Pundit. You're adding an extra N.
No, I didn't. I said pundit.
All right.
You're always editing me, Michael.
I'm helping you. I'm strengthening you.
I see. Thank you. I'm the grasshopper. Okay, fair enough. You made me even forget what I was going to say.
Well, you know, you speak in all that hip-hop ebonics. So.
Yeah, so you got to give me a little more leeway for that then. Anyway, there's a bunch of old white dudes who get to talk on the media. Here, how's that?
Why aren't I one of them?
Because you don't get to talk on mainstream media, Michael.
I'm an old white dude. Why don't I have a show on
Because
Fox?
You love liberty. You don't love the state. You're not sucking the dick of power. Yeah, that's the distinction.
I don't understand why every billionaire isn't an anarchist. If you worked your ass off and were smart enough to make $1 billion, do you think you'd love the government? Well, you might if the government helped you. But, you know, if you made an honest $1 billion, which I don't even know if it's possible, but if you made an honest fortune, you know, several million dollars, which is possible, do you think is it possible? How could you possibly love the government? Or even like it, or even tolerate it.
Because they're rent seekers. That's the problem, is usually they get just as corrupted as the politicians because they have the power to buy lobbyists. They have the power to push the government in their direction. It becomes the path of least resistance when you have that much money to get the government to do things you'd like.
You know, Colbert and Stewart have been totally taking that to task in funny ways. They've, you know, there's the Colbert Super PAC, and he's passed it on, control of it, to Jon Stewart. And they've been guests on each other's shows lately talking about it. And they do really – it's an actual Super PAC, and they're actually running ads in South Carolina. Right. Like, one of them basically called Mitt a murderer. Did you see
it? No, but that's awesome.
it said, you know – he said corporations are people, and they have a quote of him saying corporations are people. And they said, but as his job as a partner in Bain Capital, he took over corporations and gutted them and fired everyone. So if corporations are people, he's a mass murderer, which is pretty funny. And then they do things like they're on the show having conference calls on their cell phone with their lawyer saying like, well, is this legal? Is this legal? And they're just doing like insane things that in any world that has laws about these things should be illegal, but are legal and laughing about it.
Yeah.
I know the point they're going for. The point they're going for is they're saying, we need to reform this system.
Right.
And it's such a tenth measure, man.
Not even that. It doesn't change anything because you still have the system. The system's not the problem. The problem isn't how the system works. The problem is that you have a system that decides what's allowed.
Larkin said that really well, too. He said all politics are arguing over who's going to be on the throne when the real question should be why is there a throne?
Exactly. Yeah. And the other thing is, It will never work. If your goal is to get money out of politics or prevent the richest people from deciding what the government does, it's impossible. I did actually learn that in Journalism 101, literally. One of the first journalism class I ever took at university at J School was by a guy called Bob Jensen. And he was sort of radical-ish, at least as far as mainstream professors go. And he went over through the history of all the times we've tried to prevent, you know, the richest people from controlling the government. There's always a workaround. He says it's like water in a river. You're never going to keep it from flowing. It's impossible.
Well, pot's illegal because a rich man thought it was competing with paper.
And it's still illegal, you know, decades later.
More so than ever.
Decades later.
Not really more so than ever. There's ways it can be less illegal, but more so than ever in that there's this giant army to keep it illegal and enforce it being illegal.
Exactly. And if you were a billionaire, Michael, it would take a lot more money and a lot more effort on your part. And you wouldn't be able to guarantee the results if you spent all that money and energy that you spend on lobbying on trying to get rid of the government. Whereas if they spend it on trying to get the government to work their way, not only are they likely to be more successful at it because politicians love money, but they're also more likely to get what they want out of it. They're more likely to influence the results.
The way that the GOP is arranging the deck chairs on the Titanic is they're trying to get all of the candidates besides Ron Paul to agree that whoever gets the nomination will offer Ron Paul some kind of concession, like and the one that was suggested was being on a committee that picks whoever heads the Fed. And I'm like, Ron Paul doesn't want to do that.
I think somebody even used the language to make him the economy czar.
And
it's like, that's so anti-Ron Paul. He doesn't think there should be an economy czar.
And, you know, Ron Paul would probably be on that committee, and he'd probably try to put someone on it. You know, he'd say, well, yeah, let's put somebody who would want to dissolve it. And they wouldn't let it happen.
They wouldn't confirm his picks. It'd basically be a sinecure. He'd be sitting there as a mantelpiece. And the other thing is, I don't think you're going to get it. No matter who you are that wins the GOP nomination, if you're Mitt Romney, if you're Newt Gingrich, as long as you're not Ron Paul, you're not going to get Ron Paul's supporters. They're not the kind of people that compromise principle.
I know. I mean, maybe 1% of them. But nah, I don't even think that. Like, Ron Paul supporters are people who will vote for Ron Paul or probably not vote
or
probably write him in anyway. Yeah. Even if they know he's not going to win. They're like, we've come this far. You know, I read an article about Rand Paul that explained the 1,000-yard stare I said he had at that Iowa thing.
Yeah.
Where his dad was giving this stirring speech and Rand Paul was standing next to him looking like someone had just murdered his family. It was because whereas Ron Paul is basically doing this to teach and be a philosopher, Rand Paul is a politician and really wanted his dad to win.
Yeah.
And believed he could.
Yeah, and the GOP thinks they can take advantage of that, too. There's been banter about how, you know, we need to push this idea that if Ron Paul runs third party, Rand Paul is going to be ostracized. It'll ruin his chances for further success in the Republican Party.
They're basically holding a gun to his son's head. They're holding his son hostage.
Yes, they literally are trying to hold Rand hostage.
Yeah.
I really don't think it's going to work. I think Ron Paul has shown and proven that his most important motivation is principle. It's not his personal aggrandization or the benefits to his family, at least on the political level. That's not what he's going for.
Yep. So shifting gears entirely here, we had an interesting question from Skippy. He said, you know, I hear you talk about Vaporsmiths and how great they are, and I'm actually enjoying a Vaporsmith's electronic cigarette right now.
Me too. I got the cherry flavor rocking right now.
I have the vanilla full in one, and then I have two going right now.
I do that sometimes too.
And then I have the Turkish extra, extra strength.
Nice.
You know, the ones that like, when you're using it, all the insects in the room die. It's so strong.
I really like the new design for the cartomizers, too. The cartomizer is the thing you screw on the end.
They look like cigarettes.
They look like cigarette filters. Yeah.
They don't really kill all the bugs in the room. Or, I don't know, because I don't live in a room full of bugs.
Well, so. In Wyoming, all the bugs die in wintertime.
I know, man. I've never lived anywhere. I haven't seen a cockroach in 3 years, and it's bizarre.
Yeah, I used to live in Texas, so there were cockroaches 24 hours a day.
Yeah. And I used to live in California, and the last place I lived 3 blocks from Chinatown, and this is not a racial statement. If you live near Chinatown in probably in any city, but in San Francisco, you're going to have roaches because Chinatown isn't as clean as other places with food, man. There's always food garbage on the street at night. So,
anyway, back to Vapersmiths. He wanted to know about
how they work and what it is. And, you know, so you want to explain it?
Yeah, I'll give my little spiel because I did notice this about the website. You know, there's not a whole lot of guidance when you go on it the first time. So maybe we'll do a little bit of that here. There are two kinds of batteries. This is one of the things Skippy was asking about. There's the automatic battery. The battery is the main thing that looks like where the tobacco goes in the cigarette. There's some with a battery. Hold on, my alarm's going off.
Time to get up and podcast.
Oh, I'm already doing that. There's some with a button on them. Those are the manual batteries, and you got to press the button, and they'll vaporize the nicotine.
I call them full automatic and semi-automatic.
Nice. And then the automatic, it automatically turns on and vaporizes when you
suck. When you suck
on
it.
Which is more like a cigarette. I've got five of the automatics and one manual, and I never use the manual.
My manual's in a drawer. But the thing is, the manuals actually give you a bigger hit.
That's what I've heard, because I've heard you can charge them, like you can hold the button before you start to take a pull.
Well, they shut off after 6 seconds, though. But if you do a full 6 seconds, you get more vapor than if you're using the full automatic.
I see. But these things tend to give you a lot of vapor anyway. I've never had a problem with, oh, I'm not getting enough nicotine.
Yeah, Vaporsmiths are said to have more vapor than anyone out on the market.
Right, the battery's got more volts or amps or whatever that is.
And actually, there's another kind of battery. It's not a battery. It looks like a cigarette with a wire coming out of it. It plugs into the USB port of your computer, and it's powered by
that. Yes, and that's your favorite, isn't it?
Yeah, they give me a head rush, and I was a 3-pack-a-day cigarette smoker, and those give me a head rush, but the cartomizers get used up quicker when you use those constantly.
Right, right. And also, if I recall, you don't – because when I was first doing it, I was like, well, where do I put this coupon code? Because I was going to put in Free Talk Live. Nowadays, you can put Freedom Fiends instead.
Freedom Fiend, all one word.
Freedom Fiend, no S, and all one word. But you put the coupon code in at the end when you're going to check out. So don't worry about that. You'll get your free stuff or your reduced price stuff.
Yep, worms.
And so, basically with the e-cigs, I charge my battery every night. The starter kit comes with a charger. It's a little thing that plugs into the wall, and then it's got a little USB thing that you screw in. You can also take the USB thing off and charge your e-cig in your computer's USB port. I charge mine every night. Sometimes if I'm doing a lot of vaping in a day, I'll charge one while I'm puffing on the other, just so I make sure I have two extra batteries.
Yeah, I have like four of those chargers, and at night, sometimes I'm charging three
different
outlets.
Right, right. You've got a whole power strip full of Vapersmiths.
Yeah. But, they're great. We like them. And they've replaced smoking for us. Although, at the end of the month, I do this so much that I often run out and buy a pack of cigarettes for a day or two.
Really?
Which is actually kind of okay. First, I was like, I'm glad I'm done with cigarettes forever. But, you know, it's such a habit. Everything that's in cigarettes that's not in Vapersmiths is bad for you. But, like, my body's so used to it, I don't mind having it one day a month.
Yeah, I guess I can see that. Every now and then, I'll bum a smoke from somebody and I'll enjoy it. I wouldn't replace Vapersmiths with it, though. Because Vapersmiths,
no.
What I find more than anything is just the convenience. I can literally have a Vapersmith in my mouth 24 hours a day. When I'm at work, when I'm at home.
I use them in Walmart. I use them in restaurants. Yep. In public, I generally kind of try to hide the fact that I'm doing it. I haven't encountered anybody yet. I think in Walmart it'd be okay, but I think in a restaurant, somebody might get upset about it. And I don't really want to have a screaming fight with somebody about personal rights while I'm having dinner with my wife.
Yeah.
Although I would. I'd do it.
Well, it's easy to conceal, too. Like, what I do is I sort of palm mine and stick my index finger out so you can't really see it.
And then blow it out when no one's looking, like kind of like you're smoking pot in front of the teacher.
Exactly. Or if you're really concerned, you know, you can sort of open up your shirt and blow it into your shirt. Or you can hold it in for a long time and blow it out your nose and people don't really notice. Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, though, it really looks like you're smoking a cigarette, especially if you don't look too closely, because it looks like a cigarette and gives off vapor that kind of looks like smoke, although it has a LED light at the end of it. Some of them are orange, so they really look like cigarettes, but the Vapersmith ones are all blue or pink.
Yeah.
Pink, pinkish purple.
I'm a big fan of the purple ones. That's what I use mostly, because it's a really nice color of purple, almost a lavender-ish.
So, Vapersmiths.
Vapersmiths. No. Get some!
I think that's all the instruction you need. So, Oh, but the White House has issued a statement saying they do not support SOPA. But at the same time, Obama administration reportedly plans to create Internet ID for all Americans.
What's that? Like a license to use the Internet?
It's kind of amorphous and not well defined what they want to do yet, but they're doing it under the guise of this will improve your safety and it'll cut down on fraud and people stealing identities, and it would probably be voluntary at first, but knowing the government, it would be voluntary, but then, you know, you wouldn't be able to use Amazon without it or something. They'd make it something, you know, they'd force companies to do
right.
it. And, you know, privacy advocates have said, these things already exist in the private sector. We don't need you. You know, there already is SSL certificates.
Yeah.
There already is encryption. There already are ways to verify and prove that you are who you say
Catch
you are.
Puss.
Well, now those are easy to do with machines, but and they don't prove who you are. You know, basically, security experts are saying, if we need more of these, it needs to be done by the private sector or no one will trust it, and it needs to be done in a competitive environment.
Yes. Exactly, exactly.
Yeah. I mean, it basically sounds to me like the first step in an internet license.
Right, right. And of course, the things about these industry advocates mentioning these obvious truths is the government is lying about their motivation. They really don't want this to stop fraud. They just want to add to their level of control, which is why you shouldn't buy it whenever the government says one of
whenever
they say anything like that, that's not the real reason. Don't trust them. I don't know why anybody does anymore. Do you?
No. But did you know that fiend speak is catching on with libertarian rock
is
stars?
It? I'm going to play
a little, I'm going to play a little clip right here. It's Ian on Free Talk Live saying that the government is like
a dinosaur thrashing around in a tar pit.
Gay marriage, talking about how these politicians are way behind the times. You know, they're basically dinosaurs thrashing in the tar pits at this point in their, you know, the throes of their own demise. But, you know, these things take time, so it'll probably be a little while before they completely go extinct.
Yeah, which is something I was the first person to say. And I'm not saying he owes me. I need credit for this. I'm just it's, you know, we share. And I just love that. He probably doesn't even know where he heard it. That's how things travel.
Yep.
It's a good thing. It's a good thing. Fiend speak should catch on. What I would really like to catch on is worms, which we didn't even come up with. My friend David Immergluck did. But I doubt David Immergluck says that anymore. It seemed like a phase he was going through when he said it 15 years ago.
Yeah, I was honestly hesitant about worms, too. I thought it was lame. But I don't know. I can't help but say it anymore.
Its lameness is part of the
fun
of it.
Right, it's post-ironic.
It's post-ironic. I mean, your little brother says it like he's been saying it his whole life.
Yeah, who, Frank? Yeah. And he's as cool as they come.
Yeah. So uninsured turn to daily deal sites for healthcare. This was a thing on Yahoo about how people are going to like Groupon to find their health insurance now and kind of painting it like this is what it's come to, people. This is horrible.
It's
great. This is how it should work.
It should work. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I'll feel different when I'm older, but at this point, insurance is such an expense. I don't really need it. I go to the doctor maybe once a year on a bad year if I happen to get sick in wintertime. And I found that there's no reason for me to pay $100 a month just in case I need to go to the doctor once a year. It's silly.
Yeah. Well, you're young. You know, at my age, I wish I could have it. My wife has it through her work, and they don't have to provide it, but do. But they can't afford to provide it for me also. So she's insured, I'm not, but...
Well, here's another 10th measure thing we're talking about here. People are trying to reform the system of healthcare as we have it now, but the system we have of healthcare is ridiculous. I mean, there's no free market in medicine.
You know, if I were a libertarian tyrant for a day and could wave my magic wand, one of the things I would do is allow competition across state lines for health insurance like they do for car insurance. And lobbyists from health insurance companies have just repeatedly gotten politicians to block this. And instead, they end up passing this giant turd of a bill that's going to ruin everything. That was like Republicans even brought that up. Like, well, why don't we just do this for now instead? And, you know, the Democrats forcing that bill through were like, no. And I'm not sticking up for Republicans. I'm basically saying a stop clock is right once a day. And that was one time when they were right in their own 10th measure kind of way.
Right.
But it just got blocked because money controls politics. And there's no way to reform that fact other than to eliminate government.
Right. Well, here's the thing about medicine. All the things that are wrong with it are because there's too many government regulations. It's because you have this giant licensing system where people have to spend tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars, just so that they can practice medicine and have the right approvals and the right licensing. And in a system where you could have free competition in that, you'd have people that were just as good, just as competent, and could specialize in certain areas and maybe not have to be a generalist and know everything about medicine and provide their services for much cheaper because...
I'm thinking eye doctors. I mean, it seems like most of what eye doctors do at this point is performed by a machine.
Right, right. Yeah, but they have to go through the whole
rigmarole. Seriously. And, it's right. Like you look into the machine, they say better or worse, better or worse, and they do that. The machine gives them a number and they write a prescription for your glasses. Right. I mean, that's something that could be done with your iPhone, couldn't it?
It could be. At this point. Yes, exactly.
I mean, I know eye doctors do a lot more. You know, they deal with diseases of the eye, but what most people do with an eye doctor is get prescription lenses, right. Either glasses right. Or you know,
and it's a good contacts. Microcosm because then eye doctors could focus on things like LASIK surgery or things that are really necessary to have a very knowledgeable person, and all those other things could be done by, like you say, machines or by less trained people. Why have it all like that?
There's a thing you've complained about that regulation with eye doctors, for instance, is the fact that to get new glasses, you have to get an eye exam.
And it's every year, once a year.
When you're young, your eyes don't change that quickly to where you have to do that. That's kind of a jobs program thing.
You mean when you're older?
When you're older, they do change generally in a year enough that you probably need a new prescription every year or
two. It's like a bell curve. When you're 13 and 12, then your eyes do change a lot. My prescription changed a lot from when I was a teenager to when I was in my early 20s. Now it stays about the same.
Yeah. Between the age 20 and 40, your eyes don't change that much to where you probably need a new prescription every 4 or 5 years.
And that's a good thing, because here's the thing that pisses me off personally. You know, that's who I care about most, is myself. You know, and my family. And the thing that affects me about all these government regulations is A, that, but it's whenever I have to do something only because there's a law. It's whenever I know, hey, I'm sick right now, all the vitamin D and ibuprofen doesn't seem to be taking care of it, I might need an antibiotic. But I can't just go to the store and buy an antibiotic. I have to go to a doctor and have him tell me the same f***ing thing I already knew and pay him money for it. Why? Why can't I just go buy an antibiotic?
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com.
So we're about at the end of our time here. Freedom Fiends.
Freedom Fix.
I got a couple Freedom Fixes, cool things with my user's manual book. One is this woman, I hope I'm pronouncing her name right, Anna Ferreiro, a Facebook friend of mine from Portugal, who's a fan of the cast and a fan of that book, is translating that book into Portuguese for me for free, and we're going to give it away for free in Portuguese when she's done.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah. And the other thing is, I was talking to Jack Endino. Do you know who Jack Endino is?
I think you were telling me he was the producer on Nirvana's Bleach album.
Yeah, and a lot of the Sub Pop stuff.
Ah. He was like the Sub Pop's in-house producer.
Yeah, and he's kind of credited with like helping break Nirvana because he made that record sound so good. He's a fan of the User's Manual book. He's read it.
Oh, good.
And he was telling me, he said, I got your book and read about the two laws and immediately thought, he's read Mayberry, to which I confirmed a couple paragraphs later. And he said he's been a subscriber to Mayberry's EWR newsletter since the late 90s. Never invested a damn thing anywhere, but I just like his worldview and big picture. You may be the only other human being in my extremely large circle of friends who even knows who he is. Just wanted to shout out.
Nice, nice. You've actually got another Nirvana connection, too. Chris Novoselic actually really likes your work with Baum.
Yeah. Well, I have another one, too, which is that, I don't know, do I want to say this? He told her over the phone in Europe. I was in the room when it happened. Yeah.
But I guess that whole thing is getting cut out, so.
No, I'm just going to beep out the part about how I... All right.
All right, well...
That's not a happy, nice note to end on there. I don't know how many... I don't know if I could beep that and leave it so people can imagine what that is, but if I beeped his... So next week, we're going to talk about the book Steal This Book by Abby Hoffman, which... the intro of it ends with a great line, which is, free speech is the right to shout theater in a crowded fire.
Nice.
Yeah. All right.
All right, man.
Worms.
Worms.
Hello, freedom fiends. It's your boy Dean from the U.S. Get the U.S. out my bloodstream. I-O-E and that include endorphins. No one won't ask permission and I won't say please. Freedom fans, one fact that I gotta make clear.
The Freedom Fiends podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every week, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them.